Frank Gonzalez from Cinemark Theaters with the director and writer of the new movie 1917, Sam Mendes. Wow, where to begin with this one? Such a visceral epic. You're completely part of the story from the very first shot when the soldiers are there in the grass, and then it just goes from there. How much research and planning did you have to put this whole thing together?
Well, all the research we did, I think I had a basic historical knowledge of the First World War, but I didn't want to make a history lesson. You know, I didn't want to make something that required you to know anything about it. And I didn't want to make a movie that was supposed to be good for you. I wanted to make an experience, you know. And so what I looked at was first-person accounts of the war, diary entries, letters. There's an amazing archive at the Imperial War Museum in London with interviews with people who fought in the First World War. And so that was a big part of it. Because what I was trying to do is create a story about the human experience of war. And a kind of, through that keyhole of two men's experience, begin to understand the vast scale of the Great War, you know, which was a war that changed the world. It redrew the boundaries of Europe. It was the first modern war. It started with horses and carts in 1914 and ended in 1918 with tanks and machine guns and weapons of mass destruction. So I was trying to tell something about the scale of that, yet through two men in 2 hours of real time in one shot.
That's the whole thing, the idea of a one-shot movie. I mean, you kind of toyed with it when you did Spectre years back. But now you've got, you know, a two-hour movie that you're just following the guys all the way through. The amount of choreography and planning and rehearsal that went into it must have been amazing.
It was a lot. But just so you would understand, anyone who's not seen the movie, You can't build a trench the right length for the scene that happens in the trench until you walk it on an empty field, and then you dig the trench. So we started up walking on empty fields, marking the journey with flags for the trenches, for no man's land, the German bunkers, farmhouses, quarries, woods, orchards. We built all of them to the length of the conversations and the scenes that take place between the two men, towns at night. You know, so it was an enormous undertaking that we had to start very, very early because we had to mark out the journey. And then we started digging the trenches, and we dug over a mile of trenches, populated them with thousands of men. I mean, you know, it was really a labor of love, and it was incredibly detailed. And you knew that whatever you were making, you were going to see it on film because we were passing through every single part of it.
And working with the great Roger Deakins, your cinematographer, you had to plan out every shot because you're not just following the guys, you're ahead of them, you're behind them, you're doing 360s around them.
Yeah.
And so there is a lot that goes into it. And then just the ability to go from one place to the next and making it a seamless transition. So much for the eyes to feast upon, this one.
Yeah, and I thank you for saying that. I think that one of the things, you know, we needed to decide, Roger Deakins and I, is in the language of the particular language of this film, which is unlike any film I've ever made or he's ever made. You want to be able to sometimes be very intimate, and other times, like you say, see them, you know, small in the landscape. So you want intimate and epic, you know, and you need to have that constant dance, you know, that between character and landscape, so you need to understand where they're going, you know, how far they are, geography, physical difficulty, all of the things that you try and express in the normal movie, you have to do it, but within the one shot. But that was the challenge, and, you know, challenge is what gets you out of bed in the morning, you know.
Your actors your two main actors, George and Dean Charles.
Yeah.
The work that they had to put in for this one, to be able to hold and carry that film.
Yeah.
It's an amazing performance by those two guys.
Yeah, they are amazing, actually. I agree with you, and I'm pleased people are recognizing that, because they make it look very easy. Because in a way, what I was encouraging them to do was live the scenes, live in the space, live in the environment as much as act. And a lot of sections are wordless, you know. And certainly for George, who plays Schofield, it's an amazing physical performance as much as a, you know, emotional, verbal performance. When you rehearse with them, we rehearsed them on and off for 6 months, working, because we had to start with them. In other words, we couldn't build anything. So they were doing it and doing it and doing it. It was in their muscle memory. So weirdly, I got to that point where I was able to say, right now, forget you've ever done it before. You know, you're so used to it. Now you have to live it. And they were able to, which I was really thrilled about.
Ultimately, this movie is very personal for you because it was inspired, I guess, by your grandfather that was in World War I.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, it's the first script I've ever written, and it's based on family history, really. My grandfather fought in the war. He was 17 years old. He told us stories when we were kids. And one story he told about carrying a message really formed the basis of this movie. But then I took it and enlarged the journey enormously and made it into something a little bit more epic and changed the characters and all that sort of stuff. But I never would have written it if it had not been for my granddad telling us those stories. So it's not about him, but it's because of him that we made the film.
Well, as you said, it's intimate, it's epic at the same time. 1917, please see it at Cinemark Theaters when it hits the screen in January of 2020.